So this chapter six, advanced R book club. So we are looking at functions. So this chapter basically suppose that you already know how to make functions, but at the same time, it looks back how to make very simple ones. So what our learning objectives are: how to make function in R, what are the parts of a function, and we'll see some nested function as well as other things belonging to how to make a function. Okay, so let's imagine a function. How would you imagine a function in your mind? Like, what is it, a function? So this is quite impressive visualization. Okay, you have this this black dot, the surrounding things, the x and y, all this thing is a function. Okay, so let's imagine a function like this. So we have this black dot, which is the environment. And the two blocks are the function arguments. Okay, so basically they act within each other and the output is in the environment. So a function has some components. And we can get inside to see what are the parts of a function with these other functions: formals, body, and environment. Okay, so let's say that, as we know, that there's some core functions in base R which cannot be modified, such as sum, median, so that from the base R, and then all the others are new functions. So the function that you can make yourself. This new function, the function that we can make, on this function, you can use the components functions. So this formals, body, and environment to get access and see the inside. Let's imagine that we are debugging a function that someone else has made. So we don't know how it's made, what is inside and everything. Maybe it's a big function. So how do we get inside to see some specific parts of this function? So we can use these three function components. I've used an example from a previous course, which I found very interesting. And then I'll show you some other things that I found interesting from previous court. So this is coffee ratings data set. I've just cut it a bit just to show you a few vectors. So we have total cup points, species of coffee, who is the owner, then the origin, and other things. So let's say that we would like to build a function which is averaging the total points of species. Okay, so we have Arabic and for example, we filter the species as Arabic. And then we want to see what is the mean of the total cup points. So we can make a function, call it whatever we want. In this case, sounds reasonable, call it average. To make this function, what we do is calling the function syntax, and then put inside the commands for calculating the average. And then calling the average out. So when we use the function on a specific species, this case Arabic, it releases the result. So we know, we're supposed to know, we all know, do we know how to make a function, even a basic one? I think so, yes. So this is a basic function, even if there's more than one command that we recall. And I forgot to mention that in this case, I've put a little comment in it just to show you something. Then we start using the commands for getting inside the function. So if we use formal to the function, we see that the formals of this function is species. So basically, what it's we are going to specify is species. Okay, so here inside the function, we call the species. So the formals of this function would be species. The body of the function is the body of the function. So we can see if we call body on the function, it releases the whole body. Then if we do environment, it says that the function will release its outcome in the R global environment. Then an interesting part is this, that functions uses attributes. Okay, so one attribute used by BaseR is this short for resource reference, this short resource reference argument that we can basically retrieve with the attribute function. But, what does it points to the source code used to create the function. And it also, so it calls back the function itself, but also the comments. So if you want to see the comments of a function, you can call the attribute and then the source reference. Source reference. And now you can see there is a comment and the entire function. So any questions, comments, additions, personal experience, maybe? Okay. Let's go forward to what are the primitive functions. As I said, I already mentioned it a bit. The BaseR has some core functions, such as sum, mean, standard deviation, everything. These are the core functions called primitive functions. And we found those ones in BaseR. For example, if we just called sum in R, it releases what this sum is. And it is a function that does something and specify that this is a primitive function called sum. The primitive function can be built-in functions or special functions. And to access the type of primitive function, we use the type of function. If we type of sum, we see that sum is a built-in function, so that you can play around with other type of function to see if you can find a special one, what are the built-in and everything. If we try to use the function components on a primitive function, it releases null. So you don't find it. You find anything. Then another classification of the function is anonymous. So they can be anonymous functions. And this happens when you make a function inside another function. So the function inside is the anonymous function because it hasn't got any name. So as you can see, you made an entirely as a function. So for example, here there is an empty cars data set. I've selected just two vectors for shorter outcomes because otherwise it releases the list. So now with these two columns, we use this function, which says we want the length of the vector with unique elements. So like the count function. And we apply this to the entire data set. In this case, just made of just two columns. So we can see that the result is the MPG is 25 elements, unique elements, while cylinder is 3 unique elements. So we can do this with lapply and this in our anonymous function. Then we can pull out this function and give her a name. So it's not anonymous anymore. We can call it, for example, vector length. That's the same function as before. So now it has a name and we can put the name inside our previous commands, lapply and the vector length. So it releases the same result, but with difference that now the vector has a name. Okay. So this is a bit of a theory just to classify parts of different functions. So now there's other things that you can do, for example, using doCall function. This doCall basically call the result of the function. Okay, you use this unique on species, then it requires you to have one type of species. So for now, for example, just Arabic, I select this one. And this has to be as a list. This arg function will be recall with doCall to see what is the result. So the mean of the Arabic. So basically we select Arabic again. And then we do call, we can access to the results directly. So maybe you have a better explanation about do call. Okay, other things that can be done, obviously it's a function composition. We can nest functions within each other. So we can make, for example, the square deviation. So, and then, for example, with a random uniform, we can call the square and the deviation one inside each other. So to obtain the result. We can use function inside other functions. In this case, we have calculated the deviation of the squared value of the mean of the square of the random uniform. Okay. What else? So we can set up a list of different things and collect them separately to obtain the same result. For example, the deviation of the random uniform, and then calculate the square, and then the mean, and then again the square root. So to obtain the same result. Basically, one line corresponds to four lines here to obtain the same result.
Federica, this is almost like listing it out in order of precedence, correct? So the line or the function call that we have, square root mean squared deviation x, what we're doing with the lower output is just showing what is happening inside each of the parentheses, correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
Basically, they are nested within each other. So it's showing that you can obtain the same result if you use the function nested with or separately, calculating step by step from the output of the previous one.
Okay.
Another way is using the pipes. So you start from the random uniform and then you make the deviation, the functions that we have just made, then the square, then the mean, then the square root, and again, the same result. Yeah. We can pipe them.
And with, so just to make sure that the piping operation, we're using X as the point in which we're entering the string or the workflow of these various functions. And then each one of them, I noticed at the end, the parentheses does not require any additional input because it already, because we're using the pipe, it already says, well, we're going to be manipulating X. So we're taking the deviation of X, the square root of X, the mean of, sorry, the square of X, the mean of X, and the square root of X, all of which each one of those passing pipes doesn't require any additional input to the parentheses.
That's I have internet unstable, so I have some, but anyway, this is the case because we have just one vector. We have one random uniform. In case we have a bigger data frame, even if, so more columns, more vectors, we can even specify which one we would like the
okay, the calculation that makes sense. On. Yep.
Okay, just as here, so you can put the element inside. Okay, so this is the most important part. Then now we have features to add when we go forward with functions. So basically, it talks about lexical scoping, which means it's not in the meaning of, it's basically the various parts of a function. So the name masking, the functions versus variable. We can even start a new function. So from another function. And then we can look up at the part of the function. We can see, we go back to this later because otherwise it takes too long. Then there is a nice, interesting part about debugging a function. For example, if we make a simple one, just like this, x plus one, okay, and then we set x to 15, then we recall the function, which is in this case g12. The result is 16, which means that our value is added by one. Okay, so if we are debugging this function, we can use this code tools package with find globals on the function. What it releases are two signs, so plus and x. So this can be confusing somehow. So how can we solve this problem to understand effectively what the function does? What does the function does plus, does additions, uses x? Okay, so we can use the environment and set the environment of the function as an empty environment. So we are debugging the function, okay? So we are not sure about this, what's happening in the function. So we can use the environment command as before for the components. And now set the environment to empty in a way that when we recall the function, it releases an error and says, we cannot find the function plus. Okay, so now we understand that the function is using plus as operator. So that's why we have a 16 when we have put, our input was 15. So this is interesting as well. So passing through an error, we can understand what's happened. Okay, so then I've jumped a few things and we go back later to that. We can, another feature that we can add to a function, everyone knows, because when you look to the helper pane in R, you most of the time find dot 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 as a extra argument within functions. So we even have had a discussion about that in R for Data Science book club and everything. So here, as extra feature, you can add your function dot dot dot. Okay, this way you are not specifying the type of input that you are providing when you're calling your function. So basically, you can put inside whatever it's needed, not something that cannot be used. Obviously, it must be something related and that can be used by the function. So we can use this dot 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 in any case as an extra argument for the function. This is an example. This function requires a list of two elements provided as an input. Now, the second function says function with input x and any others. So we can add two extra things without having specified before, just providing dot, dot, dot. So we can add more parameters without limitations. Obviously, there must be parameters that can be used by the function, not something else, because otherwise it doesn't work. Okay. Then another interesting part is how exiting a function. Okay, so we have implicit, explicit returns, invisibility. Most famous function that return an invisible value. We have stops, all things that can be used inside a function. So we can stop a function with an error, advising the user that maybe has provided a wrong input. So you have a message. And then other exit handlers. Okay, I've left this. We will, if we have time, we go back to this on the book to see some examples. Then we have the function forms and says, in particular, it mentioned these two sentences. Everything that exists is an object. Everything that happens is a function. This is John Chambers. It's a function call. Okay, so a function basically call an object in existence. So you have an object, and then when something happens in the environment, it's because of a function that has made something, some changes. So the functions, you can use prefix, infix, replacement, or special signs. The prefix, the function names, comes before its argument. So like foofy ABC, and this constitutes the majority of the function calls in R. There is infix, when the function names comes between its arguments, like X plus Y. So they are infix forms that are used for many mathematical operators, for example, and for user-defined functions that begins and end with the percent sign as extra. So you can use mathematical operators and other which ends like, I don't know, the date, maybe. Other that ends with a percent sign. Then we have the replacement, which are functions that replace values by assignments, like the names, df, the data frames. This names function is used for you to identify what are the names. And then you use the operator for assigning a new value. So this act is the act of replacement. They actually look like prefix functions. And then there are special operators, function like this brackets, if and for. While they do not have a consistent structure, they play an important role in R syntax. As we have seen before, for example, this nice shortcut, sorry, is here. This nice shortcut, what does is selecting the first one of the elements within the vector species. So in this case, within species, we have two elements, robust and Arabic, okay? So the sorry, Arabic and robust. So the first is Arabic. With this way, double square brackets, this way, we can select the first element of the unique, within the unique elements of species. And this is one of the special signs that we can use, special operators that we can use. Let's say operators, because they do something within within inside our function. for selecting in this case, or choosing, or adapting something. What else? Okay, here it's all I have, but I'd like to show you something else, which is here. Okay, this is nice. I don't know if you have seen it. Have you seen it? This is previous cohort. This is old version. It's the notes for the old version. So I put the link to find it. Where is it? Here. Is this one here another? Yeah. In the chat. So this is nice. Where's it gone? Okay. This is nice. If we got two functions, we can see that there's some other extra examples. Here is a specification of a function using C++. And okay, and there's also some exercises. I don't know if you have seen some particular function and you have some questions that that you would like to discuss about. Here is nice. This is what the things that we were talking about earlier about piping. So here you can see the things differently. So you understand that it's a sequence of functions that you can nest it and obtain like the tidyverse syntax language is made of this sequence of functions. And so these are the notes that are from the previous cohort, and they from assembles of questions by the previous users. This here, for example, so we mentioned some parts of a function. And here is, for example, a fresh start. So let's have a look at this example. How would we change this code so that the second call of G11 is 2? So G11 says if A doesn't exist, so set it to 1, otherwise to A plus 1. So G11 is 1 in this case. We can modify it and say this way with this operator, assigning A to A in a way to have a new start, basically. So there's a few examples here as well for lazy evaluations. And this means that a function is lazy, so start functioning when it's called. It does anything if there is no a function call So this is sometimes can be like misinterpreted, but actually it's good because the function doesn't act by itself, so acts just when it's called. And here is another example. For example, you can make a function of values and assigning to a sample for X, for Y, and for Z. And then what it does is assigning values when X is numeric. So when the values is numeric, assigned to X, when it's a character, assigned to Y, the rest to, and all the remaining to Z. So you can then call the function mega model with ABC and obtain the result.
Quick comment, Federica. So inside your example, we're explicitly calling out dpliers case when. And in that instance of creating this function and another person were to run this, hypothetically, would that user also be required to install dplyr as a dependency for running that particular function? I think the answer is yes. And the
you can even add Magritte, the library Magritte.
Okay.
Which has the pipe function operator provided, or dplyr or tidyverse.
I'm going through the R packaging book club with Colin later this evening, and yeah. that this is actually one of the topics we were talking about, dependencies of writing functions. In the example we were showing, we've created a function, mega function, I think is the name of it. And then inside there, we were relying on another package to do some of our manipulation. And within that particular function call, we're explicitly stating using the dplyr form, yeah. That would become a dependency within that particular script. Then if we were to share it with somebody else, they would have to install it on their machine, or they would get an error with that particular function call, if I'm not mistaken.
You can even set your own operator when you make a package, but I'm not sure about that, how to. So this is maybe would be useful to attach the Magritte package, so you are sure that you have the less conflict as possible. So you are recalling the pipes operator. What else we can see? I don't know if you would like to talk about something in particular. You can even there's many things. For example, here is the Magritte R library mentioned in this chapter for other reasons in this case, but you can even now there is an even new operator in use, the other one. So maybe within if you make a new package, you might want to use the new operator, which is somehow a new pipe operator. So this is nice to have a look if you have other maybe questions to see or to answer. I'd like to show you something else in the book. Okay, so if we go to the bottom of the chapter and we scroll back, we can see that there's some interesting information. Besides the fact there's some exercises, we don't have time to do that. Maybe if we would like to do another session of this chapter with someone else, maybe doing exercises next week, we can even like improve the knowledge of functions with some exercises for next week. I'm not sure if it's Arthur, which is not here today because I had some problem. Maybe if I understood well, he will be here next week because we can even go forward with function chapter with some examples. What do you think?
I think that would be rewarding. One of the thoughts that I had in this chapter 6 of Advanced R, Frederic, I'm pretty sure you were on the same call with us when June was doing the, he was making references to some of the underlying or underpinning of a lot of packages in general. In the topic we were covering, it was ggplot oriented, but he was using some of these calls, the formals and the bodies, et cetera, and being able to manipulate or have a comprehension of what ggplot was doing in the manipulation. Priyanka, you probably may have watched that same video with June having this discussion. It would be a great opportunity to maybe show some exercises of what June was showing us and being able to express some of these calls within functions and do some of these exercises for sure.
Yeah. Something else I mentioned in the chapter is this. So you can even like take a package and look inside the package. What are the many functions inside? What are the primitive functions? What are not primitive functions? This is the bottom of the chapter. And it goes through this thing. So basically looking at the package and see what are the functions inside the package, what are they, and so on. Something else is within these other operators that you may, maybe you can use them. So like assigning an operator, you see, you can maybe make your operator. You know, practice is gold. So you doing some practice making some function would be the key for understanding. So, okay, any of you, I think it's all for today. We had an introduction and so the important parts that we might want to look at for making our own function. Any of you would like to take the next session next week for improving this chapter with some examples, or maybe more than one of you would like to share some exercises, present one function of your own. I think that would be interesting to do this next week. What do you think about that?
I'd be willing to volunteer for it. I don't know if the rest of the group would want to partake. The curiosity I'm driving at is kind of under the hood of R. What exactly is it doing in a lot of our, it's demystifying what happens when we make a lot of these calls, or how can we figure out how to dig in and understand, comprehend the manipulation of data within a lot of our not only just packages, but just the function calls that make up the package that make the calculation operate. That's always been an interest of mine. I'd be willing to volunteer for that. Okay. I don't know how much value it would be to others. That would be my only fear. It is it's a selfish point on myself for doing that. But if the rest of the group would be willing,
that would be very useful to all of us for sure. So we will get in touch on Slack to see if someone else will volunteer for next week. So we have like variety to discuss. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you for attending today and see you all next week. Thank you. Bye.
Thanks, Federica. Bye now. Thanks, everyone.
Bye-bye. Okay, thank you. Bye.
Bye.